online. I don't think it's in your textbook, but there is even an equation, like a mathematical equation. You put the amount of CT-based pairs, amount of ATA-based pair, the concentration of the salt, and it's going to calculate the melting temperature for you. Okay. It's really a very well defined dependence on the GC content, length of DNA, of course, and the presence of salt. So, how is DNA synthesized? We do not have time in this class to go into details. It's part of the biological chemistry boom. So we will just briefly, you know, introduce DNA and RNA synthesis. Those reactions, the basic principles are very simple. However, the way how the levels of controls and regulation of those synthesis are really interesting. So, if we have a DNA synthesis, and this is something we can do just in the test tube, this is a part of PCR reactions. What do you need to synthesize DNA? You need a template, because DNA has always synthesized based on the template, and the template is single-strand DNA. During the DNA synthesis within the cell, those two strains in the DNA duplex has to go apart. It forms so-called a replication bubble because they go apart. You get like a pieces of DNA where the two DNA are exposed and the synthesis can start. So here on the bottom is the DNA complex. DNA is a polymerase, is the enzyme which is involved in the synthesis of DNA. And DNA polymerase cannot start from the nucleotide one. Needs to have so-called primer. It needs to have a short single-strand DNA, which may be 10, 20 bases, which is complementary to the template. In our bodies, in the cells, there is an enzyme which is called primase, which is responsible for synthesis of those primers. So there is the primer, and as you can see, the primer is complementary to the template. And it has an OH group on the carbon C-prime, which is available, okay, which is three OH groups. What the DNA synthesizer does, it catalyzes the formation of the bond between incoming deoxytrinucleotide, in this picture it's deoxyated T, and the hydroxy group on the primer, which is in the position of C-prime. So, the new nucleotide is added, forming a phosphate group, phosphodiester bond between carbon 3 prime on the growing strain and carbon 5 prime on the nucleotide, which is added, in this case, adenine, and removal of the pyrophosphate. Next nucleotide is added, etc. The synthesis is proofreaded by DNA polymerase. So one DNA at the nucleotide, it's back-checked if the correct nucleotide was added or not. If the enzyme realizes that it didn't put the correct nucleotide, so instead of A, it would put C here, this nucleotide is clipped off and the steps repeat. The pyrophosphate, which is released during each step, like here, here is hydrolyzed into orthophosphate, and this hydrolysis of pyrophosphate into orthophosphate make the reactions to be irreversible. So it goes only in one direction. Also, it provides additional free energy to drive the reactions. And you need all the nucleotide, deoxy, adenosine triphosphate, these to make it complementary. There are several types of DNA polymerases. So all DNA polymerase has the polymerase activity. The newly synthesized DNA always grows in the 5' to 3' direction. All DNA polymerase, we know, they can only synthesize DNA in the 5' to 3' direction. Some DNA polymerase has better proofreading mechanism, they have higher fidelity. Some DNA polymerases glorified, it also depends on their function in the bank. So, the mechanism of DNA synthesis in Clophelicata, the three prime OH group on the growing chain provides a nucleophilicata on the phosphorus alpha of the incoming nucleotide, which is shown right here, forming the phosphodiester bond and cleaving the bond between pyrophosphate and phosphorus gamma, phosphate beta and phosphate gamma in the clinical range. DNA polymerases are progressive enzymes. Somebody knows what it means that they are progressive enzymes?
That they can correct DNA base pairs that do not match.
No.
Oh,
no.
Correct.
No, it's not the same. They have the repair mechanism, it's correct, but it does not, the progressive does not mean that they can repair the DNA. It means that...
Is it continuous?
Sorry?
Is it continuous?
That it continues, yes. So what it means that single enzyme stays attached to the template and can add several incoming nucleotides. It wouldn't be progressive, it would mean the first nucleotide, like adenine, would be attached here, the enzyme would dissociate from the complex, a new enzyme would bound and catalyze the next reaction. Progressive means that it can stay and catalyze several steps. Some of them are less progressive, it catalyzes maybe 100, 300 additions. Some of them are more progressive, they can catalyze addition of thousands of nucleotides and stay attached to the template. Okay? So the progressive means that they can catalyze several steps of the reaction. Again, polymerase move along the template in the 3' to 5' directions, and the new daughter strand is formed in the 5' to 3' directions. The rate of DNA synthesis is roughly 700 nucleotides per second. I think it's quite good, isn't it? 700 nucleotides per second. I find it's, quite good, 1 second, 21, and 1 second is gone, okay? I find it good. There are proofreading mechanisms. So the synthesis, the DNA is synthesized into 5' to 3' directions. So when a wrong nucleotide is added, like here, the DNA can go back and remove it. So there is exonuclease activities, which removes the nucleotide in the 3' to 5' directions. Some polymerases, some DNA polymerases are more complex. They can also remove the nucleotide in the 5' to 3' directions, in both directions. Those proofreading happens later, once the DNA is synthesized. Actually, there are I don't have the number, you don't have to remember it, but if I recall well, the number is once all proofreading is done, there may be one error per either 10 to 9 or 10 to 12 nucleotides. Okay. So it means that you have 1,000 million nucleotides added and there is only one error.
And so it's going to be.
Sorry?
10 to a negative 8 per base pair.
Yeah, so the precision is really excellent for DNA synthesis. As we will see later, the RNA synthesis does not require such a great precision. Okay? And RNA polymerase does not have those proofreading mechanisms. Now, how is DNA synthesized? DNA replication is similar in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. However, in eukaryotes, it's a little more complex. It's a complex process. There are about 20 proteins involved. It's not just DNA polymerase. It's also primase, additional proteins we don't need to go through. In this class, catalyzed by DNA polymerase, and it's a high fidelity reactions. DNA replication synthesis of new DNA is so-called semi-conservative. What it means, this is a parental DNA, and we can have three possible cases. There is one case when the two newly synthesized DNA, each DNA has one parental strain and one newly synthesized strain. This is so-called semi-conservative mechanisms. There is a so-called conservative mechanism. In this case, the parental DNA would stay conserved, and the newly synthesized DNA would have two new strands. And the second possible mechanism would be so-called dispersed mechanism, that only each strand in those two DNAs, which are formed after the DNA replication, so that each strain would have a small piece, which is new, and the pieces, which are old. There was so-called Meselson and Stahl experiment. They labeled DNA using nitrogen. During the synthesis, they use labeled nucleotide. They have the nitrogen 14 replaced by isotope, which is nitrogen 15 atoms. And they measured the differences in the mass of DNA using ultracentrifugation experiments. You have it described more in the details in the textbook. I don't think we have time for it, but what you need to remember, what they found out, is semi-conservative mechanism. So when DNA replicates, the two new DNA, everyone always carries parental strain and newly synthesized strain. And this is important for proofreading as well, because by the presence of the parental strain, the DNA polymerase and repair mechanism always know what should be provided in the new strain. So in addition to DNA polymerase, I would like to mention reverse transcriptase. Reverse, as we mentioned it in the lecture one, certain viruses, which are called retroviruses, they do not carry their genetic information in the form of RNA, in the form of DNA. However, they have RNA. But during the synthesis and during the replication, this RNA has to be transformed into DNA. And then it happens by so-called reverse transcriptase. So reverse transcriptase is the enzyme which uses RNA as a template and synthesize a new DNA based on this RNA template. This is a two-step reactions. In the first reactions, the RNA, the reverse transcriptase synthesize a single strain DNA, which is shown here in green and yellow, which is complementary to the original RNA. So we see the hybrid between RNA molecule and the complementary DNA. If you see DNA with the C, label C, it does not mean circular DNA, it means complementary DNA. So first the hybrid is synthesized. Now this in the hybrid, the RNA is cleaved off by RNase H, which is the enzyme which degrades RNA molecule, digested, and based on the DNA strain, which stay the cDNA, double strand DNA is then synthesized. So this would be the function of reverse transcriptase we can see in certain retroviruses. So this would be the DNA. Let's go to RNA molecule. There are several RNA molecules in our organism. If you look at the old textbook, you will see those major three ones. And I think every one of you already heard about those. As we already said, the main difference between RNA and DNA is RNA has ribose and it has uracil base. Big RNA is messenger RNA, which is the RNA which is transcript from DNA, and it serves as a template for protein synthesis. So all proteins, their sequence correspond to the sequence in messenger RNA. The tRNA is a small RNA molecule which are covalently modified. They can have covalently attached amino acid residues. They bring amino acid residue to the ribosome during protein synthesis. And based on the sequence of tRNA, which is complementary to mRNA, the amino acid residues are added to the growing polypeptide chains in the order which corresponds to the order of bases on messenger RNA. Ribosomal RNA is a part of a large protein ribosomal RNA complex, which is called ribosomes. They are the catalytic sites for protein synthesis. Synthesis, replication of DNA, synthesis of messenger tRNA, ribosomal RNA happens in nucleus. However, translation of messenger RNA into proteins happens on ribosomes. Ribosomes are located in the cytoplasm. Actually, they are attached to the they form complex with the endoplasmatic reticulum. We speak about so-called raw endoplasmatic reticulum. Lately, during the last maybe 20 years, additional RNA molecules were discovered, which is important function in our body. So we speak about SNORs, they are small nuclear RNA, and they participate in exon splicing, which is the process which is involved in maturation of messenger RNA. We will speak about it later. MicroRNA are the RNA molecules which are complementary to messenger RNA, and they inhibit protein synthesis. Messenger RNA, to function as a template for protein synthesis, has to be a single-stream molecule. When the microRNA form the complex with the messenger RNA cannot serve as a template for the protein synthesis, so the protein synthesis is inhibited. Small interfering RNA is also involved in the regulation of the protein synthesis. It binds to messenger RNA and degrades it. Okay, when messenger RNA is degraded, again, it cannot serve as a template for protein synthesis. RNA is also part of telomerase. There are the complexes which maintain the length of the chromosome. And again, there is this is addressed in the biological chemistry too. RNA molecules are also part of signal recognition particles, which are involved in intracellular protein distribution. So as you can see right here, the RNA molecule have much more diverse functions than just DNA molecules. RNA synthesis happens in a very similar way as for DNA synthesis. So the RNA polymerase catalyzes addition to individual nucleotide triphosphates to growing RNA chain. As a template is the DNA nucleotides. The building blocks are nucleotide triphosphates, and again the cytosine triphosphate is replaced by uracil triphosphate. There is a need for divalent metals. I forgot to mention it when I spoke about DNA polymerase. Both DNA and RNA polymerase needs to have magnesium cations attached to the protein, which are important for enzymatic activity. In the absence of magnesium, those molecules are not active. RNA polymerase, unlike DNA polymerase, this enzyme does not need any primer, okay? So it can start the synthesis of RNA from binucleotide 1, okay? It does not need those short sequences to start. It happens in the similar way as DNA synthesis. The newly synthesized RNA strain is synthesized in 5' to 3' directions. And the DNA template is read in 3 prime to 5 prime direction, of course, opposite. There is no proofreading mechanism, as the sequence of RNA doesn't have to be exactly matching. Okay. In addition, those RNAs are usually shorter, so the probability that there would be error is smaller than if you compare it to synthesize all along genomic DNA. So the DNA, if you look at the DNA, so the DNA is read in the 3 prime to 5 prime direction, and in the double strand DNA, it's the template. The growing DNA, messenger RNA, which is synthesized in the 5 prime to 3 prime direction, is complementary to the template. The second strain of the double strand DNA, which is not used as a template, is called coding strain. And the reason for it is, if you look at its sequence is identical to the sequence of messenger RNA, with in one exception, if there is T in the coding strain, there would be U in the messenger RNA, okay? But otherwise, the coding strain is the strain which is not the template, its sequence is identical to the sequence of messenger RNA, only T are replaced by U. Make sense?
Professor, I have a question. In the first line of this slide, it says DNTP, isn't that deoxy?
It should be, you're right, it should be NTP because it's RNA.
Okay, perfect, thank you.
Sorry.
What was the purpose of the coding strain?
So, if you have DNA, okay,
yeah,
you have two strains in the double strain DNA. Only one strain serves as a template. Okay, so if this strain serves as a template, it's complementary to the growing, to the newly synthesized messenger RNA. So if there is a C in the template, there is G in messenger RNA. If there is T, there is A. Okay?
Yeah.
However, DNA is the double strain, so you have the second strain in the DNA, which does not serve as a template.
Okay.
Okay? This strain is called coding strain, and the reason for it is, if you look at the sequence of the coding strain, it's identical to sequence of messenger RNA, because this C is complementary to G in the messenger RNA, but it's also complementary to G in the second strain, okay, in DNA. So if you read the sequence of the coding strain, it's like to read the sequence of messenger RNA.
Yeah.
The only exception is, if you have T in the coding strain, then it's U in messenger RNA.
Okay.
No problem. So here is maybe a little better picture. So you have those two strains of DNA. The strain which goes in a 3 prime to 5 prime direction is the template strain. During transcription, this strain is transcribed into messenger RNA, which is 5 prime to 3 prime direction. And you can see it here, the sequence of messenger RNA is the same as the sequence of the second DNA strand, which is not transcribed, it's so-called coding strain, TCA, there is no T in messenger RNA, it's U, but it's UCA. GAG, GAG. GTG, there is no T in messenger RNA, so GUG. So if you read this sequence, it's like you would read this sequence, you just replace T by U. Okay? Now, as we will see later, during translation, when the information in messenger RNA is translated into the peptide chain, the way how the sequence in messenger RNA is read, it's always 3 nucleotides. So the position or the identity and position of the amino acid residue correspond to the 2 nucleotides in messenger RNA. So here we have 2 nucleotides which are UCA. UCA always codes for serine, so during translation the root of messenger RNA is serine. If there is GAG, correspond to glutamate, GUG, valine, etc. The messenger RNA, when we will see later, it's always read 3 codons, three codons. Each codon has certain amino acid residue. There is no space, no base, which would say there is a space, etc. So this happened during translation on the ribosome, and we will come to it later. Now let's go back to RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase has to recognize certain sites on DNA where the synthesis of messenger RNA starts. Okay, there are specific sequences of DNA which helps RNA polymerase to recognize where to start synthesize messenger RNA. So if we look at the just look at the prokaryote right here, if we look at the template strain of DNA, and the plus one is the position of the first base which got transcribed into messenger RNA. Okay. Now, if you look at the sequences of many DNA in prokaryotes, we see certain similarities. And those similarities are located upstream. So they are like before the position plus one, which is the first base which is transcribed into messenger RNA. So very often in the position minus 10, so it's about 10 bases before the first base, which is transcribed, we see a large amount of DNA bases, and this is called Pribnov box. Okay. The other characteristic which helps to recognize the first base, which is, or the sequence, which is transcribed into messenger RNA, it's so-called minus 35 region, which have sequence, which is about TTGACA. Okay. Often we see this type of sequence. In eukaryotes, and those sites are so-called promoter sites. So those sites are recognized by RNA polymerase and other proteins which are involved in the recognition of those sites. They are so-called transcription factors, and they help to indicate the position of first nucleotide to be transcribed. In eukaryotes, we see something similar. We see so-called Tata box, sometimes called Hoogness box, which has also large amount of thymine and adenine bases located in the position minus 25. And there is so-called minus 75 region, which is sometimes called CAAT box. There are other regions which are so-called promoter sites, which are located, which help to recognize the initiation site for the transcription. However, they can be located much more far. Some sites are located like 1,000 nucleotides away from the site plus one. Some sites are even located in the transcript regions. Okay, but those are the most common one, or the best characterized. It's the CAAT box and Tata box in eukaryotes, and minus 35 regions and Pribnov box in prokaryotes. So this is how the synthesis is recognized, the termination of the RNA synthesis. There is a protein which is called Rho protein, which binds to RNA polymerase, and they helps her dissociate from the DNA, which terminates RNA synthesis. The other way of termination is the newly synthesized RNA. If there is a certain sequence, it can form such a hairpin structure, which is shown right here. Okay, so the hairpin structure is such that there are two strains in the messenger RNA which are complementary, and you can see this, how complementary they are. They have large number of GC base pairs, and they form such a steam structure and the loop structure. And this type of structure is called hairpin structure. If such structure is formed on synthesized messenger RNA, it causes the RNA synthase, RNA polymerase, to dissociate from DNA template, and the RNA synthesis is terminated. Unfortunately, we do not, the site or the mechanism for termination of RNA synthesis in eukaryotes, they are really not well known and they are not well characterized. However, there are differences in messenger RNA synthesis and modification in eukaryotes and prokaryotes, because in eukaryotes, this is somehow more complex. So here you have the structure of DNA or the model of structure of DNA, and here in the orange color is the sequence of messenger RNA. So it's the sequence of DNA which is transcribed. Are there any questions? No? So there are the sequences which are transcribed into messenger RNA. So there's the promoter sites, which help recognize the first site, and the terminator, certain terminator sequences. The messenger in eukaryotes, is synthesized in form of so-called prep messenger RNA. So there's some leader sequence, trailer sequence. There is the first residue, is so-called cap residue, which is formed by a guanosine. And this guanosine is modified relatively interestingly. It's so of course 7-methyl guanosine. So there is a methylation of the nitrogen, which is in position 7 on the guanosine base. The guanosine here is attached to the next nucleotide differently. So instead of having connections between carbon 5 prime and carbon 3 prime right here, or oxygen on the carbon 3 prime, there are 3 phosphate groups which connects to carbon 5 prime. So there is so-called 5 prime to 5 prime phosphate bridge, which connects this capping 7-methyl guanosine residues. So this is the cap right here, is this right here. And in eukaryote, messenger RNA is more complicated. It has sequences which correspond to exons and so-called introns. During the transcription, both sequences are transcribed into so-called pre-messenger RNA, and during maturation of messenger RNA, the introns are clipped off, and the mature messenger RNA, which is used for translation of the protein, carries only protein coding sequence. There is other interesting part, and this is so-called poly-L10. During messenger RNA maturation and processing, there is addition of several poly-adenine bases on the 3' end, so there is the poly-L10, and we still do not know what's the function of those poly-L10s. Okay? Certain hypothesis says that the poly-L10 determine how long the messenger RNA will be within the cells before it gets degraded. And the presence of poly-L10 help us to isolate messenger RNA. Does somebody has any idea how the presence of poly-L10 help us to isolate messenger RNA?
Because the poly-L10 is polar, right? Or non-polar.
No, you can use it as an advantage for certain type of chromatography. Somebody can have some idea how we can...
Affinity chromatography?
For affinity chromatography. If you use affinity chromatography on the resin in your column, you modify the resins with poly-U or poly-T sequences. And now they are complementary to this poly-L10, so only messenger RNA which has poly-L10 will bind to such sequences. Good. So this would be messenger RNA. tRNA, we mentioned tRNA, let's make a 10-minute break, okay, before we continue. We are at 11:11, so let's see you at 11:21.
Gotcha.
Is it okay?
Yes.
Yes.
It's beautiful now. Thank you.
Thank you.
I forgot about the break. 11:21. Go for the coffee or coke, whatever you want to. Okay.
Thank you. You wanna give my dad a call? Let me know if you need anything, okay? I think she might be going back in a minute or two.
Hello?
Psh, 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 psh. Francisco, Francisco.
How many people?
How you doing, champ? You said hello, no? What is it?
Look what this pencil can do.
Okay. What does it can do? Good job.
Professor?
Yes.
When is the test? What day is the test?
Thank you.
No, I just read what I wrote and I missed every single article. I'm horrible.
Do we have class on Monday?
No, it's a Memorial Day.
That's where, okay.
But despite that, it's a Memorial Day, because I really cannot do this afternoon, so despite the fact that it's a Memorial Day, if somebody needs a help, I can be available.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
Okay, can we continue?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. I'm ready.
Yes, yes. Everyone is, Francisco Goldsack. Everyone is excited about the RNA. So, not here. What did I finish? Oh, somebody. Francisco. Francisco, to nemůžeš dělat. So, to the RNA. As you may already know, tRNA are small RNA molecules. They have above less than 100 bases. It depends, they are not all the same in the size. You have a structure of tRNA or the scheme of tRNA molecule right here. So the molecules form such as schemes, which are shown here, schemes here, here, here. And such a loop structures. Actually, this would be like example of something which would correspond to the secondary structure in proteins. In the 3D, the tRNA forms more complex structure. It looks like L-shaped molecule. I do not have it right here. Now, there are two most important parts. One important part is so-called anticodon. And there are three bases which are located right here in this loop, which are complementary to the three bases to the codon on messenger RNA. As I mentioned previously, the function of tRNA is to bring amino acid residues to ribosomes, the amino acid residues which are building blocks of synthesized protein. And so based on the complementarity between anticodon and codon on messenger RNA, the amino acid residues are connected to growing polypeptide chains. The tRNA molecules brings amino acid residue in such way. Sorry, I will make it nicer. In such way that they are covalently attached to tRNA by the adenine base which is on the street prime end, which is the street prime end. There is always somehow longer street prime end, there is no complementary, and there is always CCA sequence with adenine being the last base, and the amino acid residue is connected through tRNA, through the hydroxy group on the ribose from the last adenine, which is the free three prime hydroxy group right here. So the amino acid residue, which is coupled to the base at the three prime end, has to be complementary to the anticodon, which is located right here. Amino acid residue attachment to tRNA is catalyzed by the enzyme, which is called acyl tRNA synthase. It's important enzyme because it has to attach the correct amino acid residue base on the anticodon. There are two different types of acyl tRNA synthase, acyl tRNA synthase 1 and 2. Again, this is about this class, but there is one interesting thing. So people have been looking how the amino acyl tRNA synthase recognizes the tRNA to know which amino acid residue attach to this end. And the first idea was, okay, the enzyme has to read the bases, which are here, or the anticodon, which is here, to know what amino acid residue attach. And it shows up, it's not the mechanisms. The information how the enzyme recognizes the tRNA and knows how to attach the correct amino acid residue is sometimes in this part of tRNA molecule, sometimes it's in this part of tRNA molecule, it's not always the anticodon. In the other thing I would like to mention right here is the structure of tRNA may be a little different. In general, all tRNA has those three loops here, one loop here, one loop here. Some may have additional sequences here, which are shown by the yellow one. So the sizes of tRNA molecule are somehow different depending which amino acid residue is going to be attached. The other structure, The other structure which I want to mention is the ribosome structure. Ribosome is a big complex, which is the place. No, Francisco, stop and go on. Which is the RNA protein complex where the synthesis of RNA takes place. The complexes are similar in prokaryotes and in eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, those complexes are larger. There are two major subunits in each ribosome. There is a large ribosomal subunit, which is 50S subunit in prokaryotes. And there is a small subunit, which is 30S subunit. Those S, somebody knows what are those S here? What does it mean, 50S and 30S? No, the S here, the S, 50S and 30S, somebody remember?
I would take a guess is the chirality, isn't it?
Chirality? No.
Okay.
No. We spoke about ultracentrifugation, and we said that we can use ultracentrifugation to determine the weight or mass of the protein. And in ultracentrifugation, a sedimentation coefficient is measured, and the unit is so-called Svedberg unit. Okay. So for large complexes, mainly protein complexes, which mass has been determined, ultracentrifugation, instead of talking about the Daltons, kilodaltons, we speak about the mass in Svedberg units. Okay. So S means that it's the size is characterized by Svedberg units. The other question I have If you put 50S and a 30S subunit, large 50S subunit of ribosome and small 30S subunit ribosome, the size of the large, of the complete ribosome is 70S. Why is it smaller? Because 50 plus 30 should be 80. So why is it smaller?
Could it be because of like the, like you have more interactions and then the protein gets more compact?
It gets more compact. It's not only just the pure mass, which determines the size. It's also the shape, which changes. Yes. Okay. Yes. So, but remember, ribosomes are the size of protein synthesis. And all ribosome has two subunits. It's a large subunit and small subunit. Before the synthesis of the protein starts, those two subunits have to come apart. The messenger RNA, which provides the information about the sequence, it's placed in between those two subunits. Okay, so during the initiation process, the subunits goes apart, messenger RNA is located between those two subunits, and they come back together. Those processes, you know, are factors again. This is not the scope of this class. The other thing I would like you to remember or pay attention to it is if you look at those structures, the proteins which are for the large subunit shown in red and for small subunit shown in the blue color, they are usually located on the surface of those subunits, okay? They are not inside of those subunits, they are usually on the surface. They, you know, moderate the ribose surface interactions. The other interesting part about this is the people have been looking for a long time, which is the most important residue from those proteins which is involved in the catalysis. Because ribose is an enzyme, it catalyzes the synthesis of the peptide bond. And interestingly, they, using a lot of mutations and changes this amino acid residue, they were not able to find the amino acid residue. Okay, the only thing they were able to find was a base. So from all those big ribosome complex is a base, which is adenine, which is directly involved in the catalysis of the reactions. It's not, so the ribosome, the enzymatic activity is coming from RNA molecule. It's not coming from the protein, I'm sorry. It's the dog, she likes to take the toys, the wood toys of my son and play with them. So they are like in the box, and if she takes the box from the shelf, she pulls the box from the shelf just to get this piece of wood and she shreds it. Okay, so if we look at the synthesis or the sequence of messenger RNA, so there are some interesting features, and this is the messenger RNA from some bacterial and viral viral messenger RNA, and you see here the names where it's coming from, but all of them have certain interesting features. And the first base, which is always translated, is AUG, and you have it right here, AUG. And this base pairs with the initial tRNA. AUG is always used to code for methionine as the residue. And if you look at the bases, several places, 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe 8 bases upstream, there is a sequence which is quite homologous among different organisms, and it has A, U, A, A, G, A, G, G, U, mainly this G, G, U, G pattern, which is very common. And this sequence is called Shine-Dalgarno sequence. is after the name of scientist who discovered it. And so it's believed that this Shanjalgarno sequence in messenger RNA pairs with RNA, it's 16S RNA in the ribosome. And the pairing between ribosomal RNA and messenger RNA helps to position messenger RNA in the correct position such that the initial codon, initial AUG codon, is positioned in the correct site. And I will show you the correct sites later. Because when we look at the ribosome, there are three sites which are important for protein synthesis, and there are the sites where tRNA binds. The tRNA brings amino acid residue. Here you have a model of the ribosome. The synthesis of the protein takes place in the interface between the small and large subunits. And so there are three sites on the ribosome. Each site is in contact with both large subunit and small subunit. We have A site, P site, and E site. A site stands for amino acyl site binds. Amino acyl site, it binds the incoming tRNA molecule, which brings amino acid residue. The P site is the peptidyl site. It's the site where the growing peptide, or the site when tRNA, which carries the growing peptide chain, is located. Once this tRNA upload, it removes, the growing peptide chain is removed, cleaved off from tRNA in the P site, the tRNA moves in the E site, which is so-called exit site. So it's the uncharged tRNA, which is really fully the ribosome. Here you have a little better structure, so you can see the contact between the anticodon loop in tRNA and the messenger RNA right here. So during the protein synthesis, there is always the tRNA in the A site, tRNA in the P site, and leaving tRNA through E site. The acceptor end of the tRNA in the A and P sites are near to each other at the site on the 58 subunit. This would be this. Those adenine residues which carries the amino acid residue located right here. And this is the place where the peptide bond is formed. Now, it's interesting because once the peptide bond is formed, it does not leave through the interface between those two subunits. If you look at the picture of the ribosome, there is like a hole, or more like a tunnel, in the ribosome. This tunnel goes through the large subunit, and the growing peptide, polypeptide, goes through this large subunit tunnel out of the ribosome. And because the peptide has to go through this channel, the protein does not, or the polypeptide chain does not start to adopt its secondary, so tertiary structures during the synthesis. First, the peptide chain has to leave from the ribosome, and after, the protein folding can start. Now, how do protein synthesis happens? So, this is the cartoon structure of the ribosomes, messenger RNA right here, and a large subunit right here. The messenger RNA is close to the 30S small subunit, but the tRNA, the A sites, are located in contact with the 50S subunit. So there is a polypeptide chain, which is growing on the tRNA, which is located in the P site, and the tRNA carries the amino acid residue right here. Now the A site accepts tRNA, which carries the amino acid residue, it goes to the A site. There is a peptide bond formation reaction. During this reaction, the growing polypeptide chain from the tRNA, which is shown in blue, and it's located in the P site, the growing polypeptide chain goes to the tRNA, which is located in the A site, right here, there is a conformational change. So now the tRNA, which is in the A site, is connected to the polypeptide chain, and this uploaded, and here is the uncharged tRNA. In the next step, which is the translocation step, which requires the energy from GTP, there is the movement of the messenger RNA and all the complex. So the tRNA from the A site, which now carry the peptide chain, moves into the B site, and the tRNA from the P site moves into the exit sites. And now the tRNA from exit sites dissociate and new tRNA can come. If we look at exactly at the peptide bond formation, so there is the tRNA in the P site, which carries the growing polypeptide chain, and the tRNA is bound to the carboxy group of the polypeptide chain. And so this would be the, somewhere here would be the first residue, and this is the way from the N-terminus to the C-terminus the polypeptide chain is growing. There is a tRNA bringing a next amino acid residue. The reaction involves a nucleophilic attack between the amino group, which is on tRNA, on amino group from amino acid residue attached to the tRNA in the A site, to the carboxy carbon on the polypeptide chain in the P site. There is a formation of the tetrahedral intermediate, which is shown right here. So there is this carbon now form four covalent bond, as shown right here. One covalent bond would be to negatively charged oxygen here. The other bond goes to tRNA, and there is a newly synthesized peptide bond right here. This tetrahedral intermediate collapses by formation of the peptide bond and double bond with the oxygen, and there is discharged tRNA, which is located now in the P site. So we would be in this structure right here, but upon the translocation, this tRNA now is going to move into the exit site. The formation of the peptide bond is facilitated by several elongation factors. One of them is so-called elongation factor G. It's also called translocase, and this elongation factor G uses the energy from GTP to help to translocate messenger RNA by one codon, and you know the next codon is becoming to the A site, so next tRNA can be attached. So this is the basic principle how the peptide bond is synthesized on a ribosome. Now, how the messenger RNA is read? The messenger RNA is read through so-called genetic code table. I will show you shortly. Now, every time in all organisms, three nucleotides code for one amino acid residue. There are 20 amino acid residues which are coded by DNA. So if we have three nucleotides code for one amino acid residue, based on three nucleotides, there can be 64 different combinations, so-called 64 codons or 64 triplets. It means that there are more than one codon which codes for one amino acid residue. Genetic code is non-overlapping, so it's 3-3-3. In the same way, genetic code has no punctuation, so there is no additional base which would serve like a space between the codons. Genetic code is degenerated, there is 64 triplets and 20 amino acid residues. We will see later some amino acid residues as tryptophan and methionine has only one codon. Some of them have four, I think the most is six codons for one amino acid residues. The number of codons correlates with the frequency of amino acid residue proteins. This is something I mentioned previously. Some amino acid residues are more frequent some amino acid residues are less frequent in proteins. Tryptophan and methionine are the ones which are the less frequent. Codon is nearly universal. What it means, the genetic code table in E. coli is the same as in humans, and it's the same as in plants. The same three bases, the same codons, code for the same amino acid residue in nearly all organisms. There are certain exceptions, but they are really rare. So it's the genetic code table is nearly universal. Advantage of it is we can use E. coli to synthesize human proteins because E. coli have the same genetic code as we have in human protein. AUG is always start codon. It's identical for methionine in prokaryotes. The first methionine which binds to start AUG codon is formulated. Additional information about start codon is provided by Shine-Darganos sequence, and in eukaryotes, AUG close to 5' end of messenger RNA is always the start codon. The stop codons, which determine the termination of protein or peptide translation, are UAA, UAG, UGA. And those codons are recognized by proteins, which are called release factors. They bind to those codons, and they stop synthesis of the proteins.
Professor, do we have to learn the, well, that chart?
No.
Okay.
Well, if you want to, you can, okay? But it's, I never memorized this chart, okay? I would like you to know how to use the chart, okay? However, the only thing I want you to remember is U, first position, A, second position, and G, I want you to remember is A, U, G, which codes for methionine, and it's also the start codon, okay? What I want you to know is, if I give you the sequence of protein, be able, based on the sequence of protein, write the sequence of RNA or DNA. So if I tell you that you have a dipeptide, which is tyrosine, arginine, what's the sequence? So for tyrosine, it's either UAU, and arginine is CGU. So it would be UAU, CGU. The next possibility would be UAC or CGC. Or the arginine has four possible codons, okay? But you don't have to know that CUU is leucine, CUC is leucine, no, please know, okay? You can always find it. If you need to have the, if you need codon to solve some problems or questions, I will provide it for the exam. Okay.
Can you repeat how you found arginine? You said CGUC or CGC or CGA. How does that, wait, can you do that again?
Sure. As I mentioned previously, some amino acid residue may have more than one codon. So the arginine is, first position is C, so C, G, if you look, C first codon, G second position, and U third position correspond to arginine, because here is arginine.
Oh, okay.
C first, G second, and C third is also arginine. Okay. Histidine, on the other hand, has also C in the first position, it's C. Second position is A, because A is so histidine, second position. And the third position for histidine may be either U or C. Okay?
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
For aspartic acid, there are two possible codons. One is G, first position, A, second position, and U, third position. The second codon for arginine is J, A, and the third is C. Okay. This is the codon for RNA. Sometimes you can see codon for DNA. Okay, when the RNA is transcribed into DNA. Both are the same one. So what's important here? Certain amino acid residues have more than one codon, such as leucine can have even six of them. Often the similar amino acid residue have similar codon. One example is here, if you look for the codon for aspartic acid and glutamic acid, J, A, U, J, A, C is aspartic acid, J, A, and J, A, G is glutamic acid. So they really differ only in the last position of the codon, okay? There is so-called bubble hypothesis, which says that the third position is not so important, okay? That there is certain flexibility, so there's maybe certain exchange in the third position, and it's not so important for the precise synthesis. Because if aspartic acid is replaced by glutamic acid, the protein structure and function is not going to change significantly. For certain amino acid residue, valine, alanine, glycine, arginine, proline, and leucine, as well as isoleucine, the position of the third codon is really non-important, because for leucine, on the third position, there may be either U, C, A, G, and you always get leucine. The same for proline, serine, arginine, glycine, alanine, and valine. Something else. I told you. Yes?
Sorry, I was going to ask if the Shine-Dargano sequence is only in prokaryotes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The other thing, this is just, you know, for your interest, please don't remember it. I have here certain examples of genetic table, codon table, where we do see certain changes in some fungi. Serine may be encoded by CTG instead of, we would have TCG in case of humans or E. coli. In certain fungi, there may be differences. Differences for glutamine residue, etc. Okay, so there are the only small differences in the codon sequence. Are there any questions?
So really quickly, these codons, are these what's on the mRNA, or is this what's produced from the codons in mRNA?
So, like so if the sequence on mRNA is UUU, the amino acid residue which will be attached to the growing polypeptide is phenylalanine.
Okay, and then what was an anticodon?
So if you would have it UUU, the anticodon will be AAA. So let's do something else. So on messenger RNA, if you have AUG, oh, this is the start codon, don't look start codon. If you have CAG on messenger RNA, so the C is in the 5' position, G would be in the 3' position. The anticodon from 5' is going to be C, U, G. Because G, so on messenger RNA, on the first position, 5' position is C, so the anticodon in the 3' position would have G. Messenger RNA in the middle has A, anticodon has U. Messenger RNA has G in the 3' position, so anticodon would have C in the 5' position.
And will the anticodon play any role in protein synthesis?
Well, of course, because the anticodon has to be attached to the codon to bring the right amino acid residue.
Oh, okay. So, okay. All right. I get it.
Okay. Because if there is mismatch, the sequence of the protein wouldn't correspond to sequence of messenger RNA. So the anticodon has to be complementary to messenger RNA.
So the anticodon for glutamine is G, U, A?
So glutamine is, the codon is C, A, let's say CAA for glutamine. So the anticodon going from 5' prime would be U, U, G.
Why U, U, G if it's...
So
G, oh, oh no, I don't get it.
Okay, so glutamine, okay? If you look at the codon of glutamine, we can have CAA or CAG.
Yeah.
Right.
Let me
do this. Well, I'm okay. I can. Yeah. So we said we have glutathione. So there are two possibilities. So the codon from 5' prime is CAA. Okay, so this is the 3' prime. So the anticodon has to be, C is complementary with G, A is complementary to U, because we are speaking about RNA, A is complementary to U, but the strength goes in the opposite direction. So what's on 5' prime in the codon is the 3' prime end in the tRNA, and what's 3' prime end in the codon is 5' prime end in the RNA, tRNA. Make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay, so if the codon is 5' prime, and this is the second possibility, is CAG on codon, so the tRNA anticodon must be G, U, C. So there are the two possibilities for glutamine. Is it better?
Yeah, it is, it is.
Something more?
Professor, some of the slides that you included in the PowerPoint, they're not in chapter 4. Do you know what chapter we can go to read more on it?
Oh.
Like the one from ribosomes, that is not in chapter 4.
The thing is, I like the textbook we have for this class. I like mainly because it has good problems compared to other biochemistry textbooks. But I really don't like mainly the DNA-RNA part. I don't like how is it covered in textbook. So I took some stuff from White and Wet, which is the other type of the textbook.
What edition is that? Is it the same but different edition or?
No, it's the same, it's the different textbook, it's different authors, okay? I have the...
I would just like to read like that part that you mentioned.
I know. If I need to go to school to FIU, okay? So if I remember, I will bring the textbook, make the copies or take the pictures, and I can post it for you, okay?
Okay, that would be awesome.
I'm not promise 100%, but I will try.
Okay. May I remind you something, send you an email?
Send me an email.
Maybe. Okay, I will. Thank you.
Anything else?
Professor, this might seem like a silly question, but I'm not quite grasping it. Why, for the codon in tRNA, does the A go to U?
Because this is the RNA, okay? Remember, DNA, A is T, but in RNA, we don't have any thymine. So everywhere, so A complements to U, because it's RNA.
Thank you.
Remember, in the bases are, the five common bases are A, C, G, or T and U. But T is only in DNA molecules and U is in RNA molecules. So C always complement this G, and if you have RNA, A complement to U, or even between DNA and RNA, A complement to U because there is no T in RNA, or okay, so everywhere where would be T in the complement, there is U in RNA, and A is complementary to U. If you remember the structure of the bases, so there is the oxygen in the position 2 and 4 in uracil, and in thymine there is the oxygen in the position 2 and 4 and methyl group in the position 5. So uracil and thymine has the same hydrogen bonding pattern because of the same position of oxygen. The only difference is the methyl group. So since A can form the same, so the adenine can form the same hydrogen bond pattern with T and with U. Does it make sense what I'm saying?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, anything more?
So today or like soon you will post the chapter 4 PowerPoint on the homework, right? For chapter 4?
Chapter 4 homework, I can do it right after the class. 4 and PowerPoint 4 and 5. No, only, well, 4, yeah. And 5, I can do 5 as well. So, any more questions?
I have a question about, do we have to always, for the tRNA, do we have to say it from the 5 to 3? Like, for the example we had, I think it was GUU. Do we have to say UUG if we have like a test question or anything?
It really depends, okay? I may give you the sequence of the peptide, let's say for amino acid residue, and I will tell you write the sequence of messenger RNA and DNA, and you know, specify the ends. Specify the 5' and 3' end.
Okay.
But the codon and anticodon, they are antiparallel. It's the same like in double-strand DNA. Those two strands run in the antiparallel direction. So when there is 5' on one strain, there is 3' on the other strain.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
For the test on Wednesday, how is it gonna be? Like, can you talk about like if it's gonna, what time it's gonna be, or like where do we have to access it?
It will be in Canvas. Okay. It will be in Canvas, and the test will start from 10 to 11.
10 to 11, and then we have to log in to Zoom.
You will have to log into Zoom, yeah, because I want to see you.
Okay.
And everyone will have to have the video on. If you don't have video on, you will be zero for the test. I need to see your faces, okay, that you are not checking, you know, you know, going through the textbook, etc.
And we will have, so it will be writing questions?
I think it will be writing questions.
And then do we have to, like, also, like, draw structures and all that?
No, this would be a little too difficult, okay? So, but you still, I may give you, let's say, sequence of tetrapeptide, and I'll draw the name of the, which amino acid residues are in this peptide.
Okay, and I guess the math questions will be, like, putting, like, the result, right?
Well, if there is some more, like, time demanding questions, I will give it this part, which is home take exam.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Can we use scratch paper for the exam?
I don't think you will need scratch
paper. Okay.
So we don't need a calculator or anything for the online exam?
I don't think you will need calculator for online exams, but you will need calculator for home tech exam. Or computer, you can use computer instead of calculator. Yeah.
Professor, and for the home take part, how many questions is it going to be? And do we need to submit it the same day or next day, or how is it going to be?
I think I will give you 48 hours for the home take exam. So if I give you exam on Wednesday morning, I will post it at 9 o'clock in the Canvas. I will want it back on Thursday 6 p.m. something like that. So you will have like 2 days to go.
Okay, and do you know how many questions is it going to be, like the home take part and the other part, like the online part?
So the online part, let's say 6-7 questions, and the home take 5 long questions.
Okay.
How much, like, are each part, like, worth?
The same. So each part will be worth 25 points. So altogether, the exam part will be 50 points. 25 points from in-class exam and 25 points from the home exam.
Okay. Thank you.
Looks like you really don't want me to start chapter 5.
And Professor, so how do we submit the take-home exam?
I will post it as an assignment in Canvas and you will submit it through Canvas.
Through Canvas, okay.
Anything more?
So Professor, we will log on, we're going to take the exam, and it'll be submitted through the Canvas while we're on the Zoom, and then we'll be doing the class after?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to be 100% clear.
Professor, someone asked in the chat if the online part is going to be concept-based.
I really don't know what you mean by the concept-based. I will want you to recognize the amino acid residues, peptide, or other properties. There may be some short questions about, you know, let's say I give you a mixture of two peptides, what's the best way how to purify them, separate them from each other, you know, identify which type of chromatography to use. I can give you some results and, you know, from certain separation technique and say, you know, analyze those data for me, what does it mean, etc.
So I'm guessing that if you have like 6 or 7 questions, they will have like different parts, like A, B, C or something like that, right, or no?
Some may not, it depends on the question, yeah. I didn't write the exam yet, okay, so I don't know. There may be 4 long questions or 7 shorter questions, I don't know, plus minus, yeah. Doesn't really matter if there's 5 or 6 questions, guys.
Yeah, it's just like we're never like taking an exam from you, and I feel like at least for me, that was like a concern, like knowing like how the test was gonna be structured, because if it was like in class, it would have been easier, but when it comes to like computers and everything, it's just like something like completely new, at least for me.
Yeah, And for me.
About that, you know.
What about that? You know how new is it for me?
Yeah, I know. It's new for everyone.
Okay, it's new for everyone, yes. But if you study, if you can, you know, answer the questions in the textbook, you should do well. Okay? But don't just think, oh, you know, it will be, you know, remotely, so I will put, you know, 5 different textbooks around and the cell phone close and I can Google and, you know, all the questions. It's not going, you know, you need to study for it, okay? Because even in the, you have certain time, you know, restraint. So yes, if you cannot Google everything so fast, okay?
Professor, last question. Is it going to be multiple choice or everything's going to be written?
Everything should be written. There may be some question which is like a choice, you know, but majority will be written.
Okay, thanks.
I just don't like multiple choice questions.
Also, are we going to need to use lockdown browser?
No, I don't want to use the Honor. Okay, because what I heard from my colleagues, it didn't work always so well.
Do you specify or like how much do we have to write, or is just like we answer the question and that's it?
You answer the question, okay. What I really want is, take it this way, I'm going to grade it, okay. So if each question you have 2 pages of writing, it will kill me, okay. So what I want to hear is, sometimes the answer is 1-2 words, okay. I want to hear the correct answer, okay. If, you know, if I ask you what's the color of sky and you tell me, well, there are different possible colors starting da-da-da-da-da-da, what I really hate when, you know, student, you know, put all the possible questions, oh, but one of those 10 possibilities I wrote down is the right one, so I should get full credit for it, okay? You know, write the answer, okay? Don't write like 2 pages of all the stuff around, just put in the answer. Anything else?
Another question, I'm so sorry. Do you want us to put the Zoom in the same computer, in the same device that we're taking the exam on, or do you want us to put the Zoom on another device and...
The same device. I don't expect you to have, you know, so many.
Okay. Okay.
Professor, do you give out partial credits for your questions?
Yeah, I usually do the partial credit grading. Yeah. So let's say you didn't answer really correctly, but you are on the right path, or you read the structure, but you forgot, you know, 5 atoms there. I give you, but the peptide bonds are there. I give you, but the side chains is not correct. I give you partial credit.
Professor, in order like to regulate the exam and everything, I don't know like how it worked for you last semester, but are we able like to mute ourselves so we don't get distracted by the sounds?
Yeah, and... you can mute yourself, but I want to see your faces on video.
Okay. But we should mute ourselves.
Yeah, because otherwise it would get so noisy that it would be more distraction. Okay, anything else?
Professor, you said to have Zoom on the same device that you're taking the exam. Is that because you want us to share our screens, or...?
No, this is because I want to see that it's you who is doing the exam, or not your friend, or you are not, you know, looking in 100 different places how to find the answer.
It's just that my problem is that I have, I don't have a webcam on my computer. What I usually use when I do have my video on is I watch the lectures through my phone. So mm-hmm. Would that be okay, or?
In such case, yeah, use your phone for the Zoom and the computer for the answers.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Send me an email, or I will be available Monday at 10 a.m. If Monday from 9 to 10 is not good for you, let me know, we can schedule some other meeting. That I would be, you know, I'm willing to answer your questions. I just have busy this afternoon, but if you send me an email, I will work with you to find a good time for you. But for everyone, I will be available on Monday at 9 o'clock. Have a nice day, have a nice weekend, enjoy Memorial Day, and study for the exam. See you soon, guys. Bye-bye.
On your bus.
Thank you.
See you Monday. Yeah, okay.